And now part two of Shira's exclusive interview with Sydney Livni.
We are willing to absorb them here because this is according to our law of return, that each and every Jew comes to Israel, becomes an Israel, become an Israeli citizen in a moment in which he lands in Roshi, in Ben Gurion Airport. But yet, if they choose to live elsewhere, we respect it. But we also demand the international community and the world leadership to defend them from this kind of vicious hatred against Jews. Zoabi, as I said, equal rights and democracy is part of our, not only platform, part of our beliefs, but there is part of democracy is also the right of every democracy to defend itself. And I act against Hamas participations in election, against Hezbollah participation in election, and frankly, as a minister of foreign affairs, I went all over the world, met with the world's leader, trying to convince them to have a universal code for election, for democracy, saying that democracy is more than voting. It's about values. So those who want to participate in elections need to accept also the values of democracy. And part of the values of democracy that you cannot and you shouldn't use force in order to achieve your political agenda. And in Israel, our Supreme Court decided that Kach, a racist party, cannot participate in election. And it was okay, because being a racist is against the nature of democracy. So I was against another bill that was put a few months ago saying that we can fire Zoabi from the parliament during the term. I said, and without any judicial decision, just, you know, us. Members of parliament trying to kick out one another member of parliament. I said no to this. I stopped it. I was criticized from right-wing on this. But I said, as long as this is before elections, according to the law, and by having also a judicial judgment, this is something that is part of the system. It's okay. It's part of the constitutions all over the world. The only place which is that you don't have this kind of limitation is the United States Constitution. I know that because I raised it in my former meeting with the United States Attorney General, and I was speaking about democracy, how to defend democracies in all these places in which the extremists are abusing the system in order to get power. And then I learned that, it's the best democracy without any limitation, the United States. But I believe that in this region we can put some limitations. And we also act against a member of Kach, a member of this racist party, Baruch Marzel, who wanted to participate in elections. So it's not against Arabs. And when I watched what Zoabi said, and when our Supreme Court judge, Miriam Nahor, said that the spirit of what she said, Zoabi, is supporting terror, so with all due respect, we can defend ourselves from this kind of abusing democracy, but it's in the Supreme Court now. We are waiting for the decision, and we would respect this decision. Changing the system. Well, I checked all the systems in the world. There is no one good system. But I think that the change that is needed is that in the moment in which we know what are the results of the elections, we know who's the prime minister. Because now, after, you know, we are talking about coalitions, who will join whom and how and why. And this is the moment in which small parties are getting whatever they want in order to join a coalition. And the prime minister, during the term, needs to pay for his own survival. And therefore, the best thing is that the leader of the biggest party would be the prime minister. It's going to create other problems, like a minority government. Like it can create other problems, but I think that this is the best outcome. As long as if we have just small parties, we are going to have a runoff between the two biggest parties, if we have less than 20 seats or something. We have a bill. We tried to get the support for this in the past. We couldn't, maybe now. Well, how can we make peace with all the assurances of preventing Hamas to take over the place? You know, in the Middle East, and this is the nature of to be a leader, the meaning is to choose between sometimes bad options. Now, let's imagine what would happen without an agreement, okay? It's going to become one state between Jordan River, Mediterranean Sea, and it's going to be very violent. Because all those speaking about a bilateral states like something, well, it's nice to have two binational states, to have Jews and Arabs living in harmony. It's going to happen. It's going to be Bosnia. It's going to be violent, and it's going to be here. So my deep understanding is that this is the worst-case scenario. But I need to give an answer also to our security needs. It doesn't mean I would not support an agreement at any price. And there are certain parameters that we would not compromise on this, and one of them is Israel's security. The future Palestinian state is going to be demilitarized. By the way, Gaza is not going to be part of the Palestinian state as long as Hamas control Gaza. They need to change. And we are going to withdraw in stages. And we need to check that in each and every part that we are living, Hamas is not taking over. But yet, there are calculated risks in any agreement. But also in terms of the threats that we are facing, a war between states, and especially between Israel, with the strongest army, with the United States as our ally, we can face it, and we can win this. Now we are facing terror inside territories, and we need to act against the territories, trying to avoid civil casualties. We don't have, you know, it's a completely different and more complicated war that we are facing. And frankly, you know, talking about, for example, Lebanon, we have Hezbollah there, and they are getting more and more power. Does somebody suggest that we would conquer Lebanon, keep our forces there, and occupy Lebanon because there are threats coming from Lebanon to Israel? The answer is no. It is based on deterrence. It is based on their understanding after the second war in Lebanon that we would not give up and we would answer, and quite a severe and strong answer when they are acting against us. So I cannot give you assurances for this, but I can assure you that in choosing between the options, this is the best option. Okay, that's it. More questions.
We're opening it up for more questions. Okay, so many hands. I don't know where to start. We'll go to this gentleman right here.
Yes, Mrs. Libby, 6 years ago, you had the chance of saving us from Mr. Netanyahu, but you weren't willing to pay the price to the Haredim. Is that something you've read today? And if I give you my voice, how secure or how certain can I be that you will not to play dirty enough to get the power and stay in power and not stick to your principles? And
so... Can you like specify what the question is? Is that okay? Go ahead.
Okay. Recently, the Meretz is campaigning, saying that you might join Netanyahu and have a coalition together. Is that possible that you would have a joint coalition?
So the question is that would she have a joint coalition with Likud? Young woman over there.
I'm just wondering if Minister Livni has any comment on the state controller's report that came out today.
So the question was if Mr. Livni has any comments on the state controller's report that came out today. And gentleman over here.
I would like to ask the minister, in future Palestinian peace talks, do you see Abu Mazen as being the number one person to go to, or which replacement do you see could you work with?
So a replacement for Abu Mazen and who she could work with. Gentlemen.
You talked about democracy a lot, and I was born here just like yourself, and what bothers me is, isn't it time to invite the Arab party to be part of the government? And I'm not left-wing.
Is it time for the Arab parties to be part of the coalition?
It definitely will confuse the rest of the world.
They already refused. They said in advance that they would not join.
Okay, and the gentleman right there.
In an interview last week with Zawabi in Al Jazeera, she said that you would actually be more dangerous in Netanyahu because in the end...
She's right. I maybe make peace.
I agree with you, but that's not what she said. What she said was that in the end there still would be no Palestinian state, but that you would wind up winning a lot of international support, which would only postpone the delay of the Palestinian state, which would allow for the Jewish demography to increase, which would eventually result in a one-state solution anyway. Any comments on that?
Okay.
Well, I'll start by giving an answer to this. I can get the trust of the international community up to a moment in which I would translate what I say into an action plan. And frankly, they trust me because they know that I'm not just speaking about the Palestinian state as an Israeli interest, but this is what I do. And since they know what's happening in the negotiations room, they know that I have my own priorities. And as I said, it's not making any agreement at any price, but it's making an agreement based on parameters that the world accepts as legitimate parameters. Israel security, blocks, no right of return, all this stuff is being supported by the international community. So I'm not looking to waste time. I think the time is working against those believing in two states for two peoples, because we have more and more extremism in the region, and there are less and less leaders that are willing to take the chances when the public opinion is against leaders who are making, hopefully, decisions for peace. And therefore, for me, time is of the essence. So I don't think that you would vote for me, but yet, this is what I want to convince you, that we are truly serious. Listen, I hate politics, but this is the reason for me to be in politics. So trust me, I'm serious on this. Is Abu Mazen the real partner? I mean, he's there. I'm not choosing the Palestinian leader. I wish I could. After the attack in Tel Aviv, the terror attack in Tel Aviv, Netanyahu said he blamed Abu Mazen. He said everything is about incitement and terror and he's to blame. And what I said publicly also in Hebrew, and I said with all due respect, Abu Mazen is not the Israeli prime minister. My expectations from the Israeli prime minister is to look on the other side, to see the advantages, the disadvantages, the problem, who is there, and to try and work together and to understand that, well, nobody is perfect, not even Abu Mazen. And I have criticism on some of the decisions that he made, but he's not a terrorist. He supports the idea of two states for two people, so there is hope with him and there is no hope with Hamas. And I don't know who's coming next. And in a way, I want to sign an agreement with somebody who has a signature right on a bank account which is empty. I mean, Abu Mazen cannot deliver in Gaza. And maybe he's too weak also in the West Bank, also giving an answer to this. But when we sign an agreement, Israel is going to have borders. We are a state without borders. And it's going to be legitimate. And we can have the support on our security needs. And all these things are part of an agreement, so I prefer to reach an agreement. I prefer an agreement on unilateral steps. And this is a change that we can bring because, as I said before, Abu Mazen understand that the world doesn't trust Netanyahu. So he's working now with the world against Israel. What we can do is work with the world against Hamas for an agreement, but also against some of the Palestinian demands now that are really not legitimate, also in accordance to the parameters that the international community is writing as part of any fair and just agreement between us and the Palestinians. Well, about the statement, Crawler, listen, you can judge it yourself. There is no need for any more explanations about this. It's important to say that when we choose somebody to be the prime minister, we are choosing not only ideas and agenda and platform. It's also about the person, about the personality of those that we are choosing. And I think that this is enough for now. And would we join Netanyahu? Listen, Netanyahu said that there's a huge gap between us and him. And he's right. Now, I'm talking this evening and every evening about the need to change the trends and the way and the path that he's taking Israel to, especially Bibi Bennett, which is disastrous, really. And we want to form and to create another government to take Israel to a different way, a way of hope and not just despair. And this is the government that we are going to create. And we would not support Bibi's Bennett's way or the way that they are taking Israel now. So it's not about supporting a person, but it's supporting a vision. And their vision, it's not our vision for the state of Israel, so we would not support them, and we would not support their vision, but we are going to win anyway. And hopefully, Hamza. But asking about the ultra-Orthodox. I was asked about 2000 or now, in which I got the possibility to create a government. And I said no to the request. Well, requested is the understatement of the year, of the ultra-Orthodox. But I want to share with you what was the situation then. This was the end of the tenure of the government. Olmert left. We had just 18 months ahead. They wanted money, but not only money. This was during the Annapolis process. We negotiated with the Palestinians. And what the ultra-Orthodox want more than money is that I would say publicly that I stopped the negotiations. They said it in a different manner, that while discussing all the core issues that are on the table since Oslo, I would say that Jerusalem is not on the table, something that would have stopped the negotiations in a moment. So I have my own priorities, and I'm willing to pay some in order to get something which is more important. But what they asked me then is to give up everything that I believe in and just to be a prime minister for my own personal, I don't know, survival, ego. And I believe that it was not the right thing to do. And therefore we went to elections. And after the elections in 2009, we were neck to neck with Netanyahu. I was the biggest party. Well, my party was the biggest party. But Netanyahu created his own government with his natural partners, and I decided to go to the opposition. And I had great speeches there against Netanyahu, but yet I couldn't change or influence the situation. And last elections, I decided to join the government. No, it's too much, thank you. I decided to join the government with my 6 seats. And I'm glad that I was there, because we negotiated, we launched the negotiation, we got the support of the world for a while. I stopped all these, bills that came from the Jewish home and the Likud, of annexing territories, of acting against minorities, all this stuff. As a minister of justice, I could stop it. But yet, during the last month, I discovered that Netanyahu and Bennett are really working together against everything that I believe in. So I cannot support this anymore. So the only way to get out of this was to win these elections, to form a new coalition, to form a government, to relaunch negotiations, to act against terror, to give some hope to young people who is living there, who is living here, to absorb new immigrants who would come to Israel, to have new growth in terms of Israel economy, to take Israel out of the isolation. Well, everything here is not just slogans before elections. We know how to do it. We believe that we can do it. Please believe that we can do it and vote for us. Thank you.
Shira Nestor from Arusheva. I made Aliyah last year where I was a teacher in America, and I really appreciate you as a woman, as a leader, taking a firm stance on something you believe in and articulating. But as a teacher, I get worried about the idea of bullying and the message that it sends when somebody's bullying another child, and then we give them what they want. Are there limitations to what we can negotiate here? And also, what message does it send if we're negotiating with people who time and time again commit acts of terror?
We are not negotiating with the terrorists. We are negotiating those who represent the conflict, which is a conflict, and we need to negotiate, and the negotiations are quite tough negotiations. But Abu Mazen doesn't support terrorism, so against terror we need to act in a strong military, to take this military option, but try to achieve peace with the others. We make a distinction and we differentiate terror from those who want to live in peace with us, but they have some terms that sometimes are not in accordance to our terms for peace.
Now, you were also quoted as saying he's not a terrorist anymore.
He used to be.
How do we know? You know him, I don't know him. How
no, it's not a personal issue, I can assure you. That also according, if you would hear what the head of our security services is saying, he stopped a new intifada during the operation in Gaza, Abu Mazen, in the West Bank. So these are facts. It's not the way I feel toward him. It's a matter of
thank
fact.
Thank you very much.
All right, folks, thank you, everyone, for listening to the program. And thanks to Shira for getting that interview. Great job, Shira, as always.
Thank you. And, you know, another message to the women out there, Queen Esther, Tzipi Livni, whatever your policy is or what you believe, we all have an obligation, a duty, and a responsibility to step it up this month. This is the month of miracles. And if we really believe in our heart that we can accomplish things, then with the power of the mind and the power of Hashem, we could do it.
All right, well said. And again, any questions, comments, concerns, or any topics you'd like to like me to cover in the future? Sorry, what's up? Are any questions, comments, concerns, or any topics you would like me to cover in the future, or any guests you'd like me to interview, please send me an email to messiahhour@gmail.com, and you can find this program on YouTube. Type in Messiah Hour with Ari Lewis. You'll find the playlist and the play channel. You can subscribe to it. Check out all the interviews. Thanks again to Shira for covering this and interviewing Sydney Levy. Thanks for Sydney Levy for coming on the program. And everyone have a great day. Shabbat Shalom.